How do we treat people? How do we treat people right? Your biggest problems and mine are people problems. It's just the fact of life. Especially getting along with other people. So verse 1, he begins off addressing the very issue. As my brothers, as believers in our glorious Lord Jesus Christ, don't show favoritism. Right in the beginning itself, he begins talking about how do we treat people, and then we will talk about it a little more explicitly today. We are in the middle of a series called Real Mature. We're talking about what James talks about, how a mature person looks like. And in each chapter, chapter 1, chapter 2, chapter 3, chapter 4, and chapter 5, in each chapter, the author James explores the maturity of what does a maturity of Christians should look like. In each chapter, he gives a mark of a mature person, the sign of a mature person. Last week, we looked at the first sign of a mature person. The first sign of a mature person is positive under pressure. He addresses the issue of problems in our life and how problems are inevitable, unpredictable, and are of many kinds, and how they are going to be part of our lives. Therefore, problems, you need to learn to be positive under pressure when you face problems, specifically because problems have a purpose for our lives. Now in chapter 2, he addresses a whole different issue, talking about how churches treat people, Christians treat other people. He talks about how do we learn to be sensitive to others? How can we be sensitive to other people? Remember, whenever James starts with a sentence with my brothers, he's getting ready to nail you. So that's simple as that. He's going to be harsh, he's going to be tough on us. He's talking about prejudice, talking about partiality, and talking about favoritism in relationships, in how we develop relationships. The New English Bible, the translation, calls it snobbery. We read it as favoritism, but another translation calls it snobbery. A snob is somebody whose nose turns up when their eyes look down, you know? Somebody who always thinks that they're better than everybody else. The Greek word is a compound word. It actually literally means to receive somebody's face, to receive somebody at their face value on the basis of how they look. So it's technically a superficial judgment, because you can only see the face, right? And you're making judgment on the basis of how they look. The same verse in Good News Translation says this: never treat anybody in a different way according to their outward appearance. Now that's a common social disease among us, especially in churches. It was there, not just today, by the way, it was there right in the first century church. And that's why James is addressing that very issue right in the beginning, head on. And he says, you better learn to treat people well. Real maturity is being sensitive towards others, towards those who are around you. So I'm going to talk about this issue in two different ways. Now just follow James's words, and from verse 1 to 13, as he addressed this issue, I'll just simply expose that passage and divide it into two parts. The first one, he talks about how do we generally treat people. And in the second half, we will look at what are the steps that we can take in order to treat people right. Does that make sense? Okay, let's talk about how do we generally treat people. Now, all of you may not do that, but I can bet most of us do this, the treatment of people. In order to deal with treating people right, we need to know what are the common areas of discrimination. Number one, appearance. Of course, James right away starts talking about it. Appearance. We discriminate often because of appearance. Beauty is everything in this world. That's why our soaps sell, fairness creams sell, even though they don't work. You know, all kinds of beauty products sell, and people make money off that. We judge people on the basis of their appearance, how they look, how they dress. How your dress definitely influences how you relate with people. If you know, somebody once said like this, it might actually happen in Indian church, by the way. If somebody has a long hair and a beard, that's why I grew beard for today. Okay? If somebody has a long hair and a beard, you will walk up to them and say, Jesus saves and he also shaves. Even Christians get caught up in the power, you know, in the dress for power and dress for success and dress for to be cool. Appearance is what on which basis we usually judge people. Number two, ancestry. We judge people according to their race, their nationality, their ethnic background. In our country, in the case of our country, it could even be possible that we begin to judge people on the basis of which caste they come from. I remember reading a story on somebody's prayer to God and asking God how the church has become very discriminative, specifically with regards to how they treat people on the basis of race and color and, you know, stuff like that. And he said, God, I'm doing everything that I can. He's praying. This is one believer praying to God and saying, God, change my church kind of thing, right? So he's saying, God, I've been trying my best to help the church to reconcile and to stop discriminating people on the basis of their ancestry. No matter how much I'm trying to get in and try to change, they wouldn't just let me. Do something about this, God. And God looks at him, God began to speak to him and said, I understand your pain, but don't worry. I've been trying to get into that church for the last 20 years and I still can't get in. And hopefully God won't say that about Capstone, by the way. So we judge people on the basis of their appearance, their ancestry, or on the basis of their age. That we decide the maturity level of a person on the basis of their age. It has been the age-old problem, isn't it? That we decide whether a person is smart enough or wise enough to exhibit wisdom based on their age. We assume that the older a person looks, the smarter that person is, or wiser that person is. We assume the younger a person looks, the less wise that person is. Granted that that person does not have experience, but that does not mean it's a measure of their wisdom. Remember what God spoke to Jeremiah when he called him to become a prophet for the nations. Jeremiah gave the same answer that we would probably talk about Jeremiah if Jeremiah is a prophet, on the pulpit. He said, God, I'm too young to be a prophet. And God says, no, that's not an excuse for me. I will take you, the young man, as young as you are, and make you a prophet, not only for Israel, not only for Judah, but I'll make you a prophet for the nations. So age, I don't think God cares about our age. He will use anybody who's available, by the way. So you can't judge people on the basis of their age. Number four, we judge people on the basis of achievement. We judge people on the basis of how successful they are, how basically our society, the world, gushes over winners, successful people, and forgets those who are losers. It's just our nature. One minute we are a hero, and the other minute we are just a zero. Look at the way Indian media swings, Indian newspapers swing between India winning and India losing a cricket game. That's enough. We just understand how we treat people on the basis of success. Success and status are key words for us in this society right now. And James says, don't do that. Don't do that. Don't ask for special treatment based on what you achieved in your life. So we treat people on the basis of their appearance, their ancestry, their age, their achievement, their affluence. Number five, their affluence. That's the most common distinction. We judge people basis on the basis of their wealth, and that was a problem in that church. Based on whether they are rich or poor, based on their economic status. So this is the area James picks up out of all the other issues and talks about this is the worst of discrimination, he says. In verses 2, suppose a man comes into your meeting wearing gold rings. In fact, if you actually read the Greek word, it means suppose a man who walks into the meeting with gold fingers. Basically, literally, he has all gold all over him. That's what the expression of James was. In those days, let me just continue to read. Meeting wearing gold rings and fine clothes, and a poor man in shabby clothes comes in. Let me pause there. He used the word fine clothes because in those days, rich people would get tailors to sew gold into their gold armaments into their dressing too, because they wanted to show off how wealthy they are. If they don't have space enough in carrying gold on their hands and neck around their neck, they would even show it off on their clothing. So that's what he's trying to address. If somebody walks in like that, and a poor man with shabby clothes comes in, and if you show special attention to the man who's wearing fine clothes and say, here's a good seat for you, but say to the poor man, stand over there, or sit down on the floor at my feet, have you not discriminated among yourselves and become judges with evil thoughts, evil motives? You know, somebody, an author called Guy King, calls this the case of nearsighted usher. He's got a medical condition. He's got only nearsightedness. He can only see gold. This kind of usher sees only gold, and he ushers all the rich people in the front rows. James doesn't criticize the guy for being rich. Please understand that. James is not saying there's a problem in being rich. What James is trying to address is to the members who are treating rich people with partiality, with favoritism. You can stand over there in the corner, or you can sit on the floor. Literally, in the Greek, it means under my feet. Talking to the poor man. He says, that's the ultimate put down. You can't do that. So as he goes on further, talking about favoritism, he talks about three problems with favoritism. Let me just point them out to you. Three problems with favoritism. Number one, favoritism is unchristian. Favoritism is unchristian. That's why he starts off verse 1 by saying, my brothers, as believers in our Lord Jesus Christ, our glorious Lord Jesus Christ, don't show favoritism. He started off by saying, you have the name of God on you. You bear the name of Christ. If you want to be like Jesus, you can't play favorites. Favoritism is incompatible with the name. We are family. So this word favoritism is used only 4 times in the Bible. Every time, it's referring to God, and it says God does not play favorites. Romans chapter 2, verse 11. God does not show favoritism. If there is one place in the world where there shouldn't be any kind of discrimination, that has to be the church. It has to be one place, no matter who you are, what your background, you're welcome. We've been working really hard to do that in our church. That there are no favorites. There is no show of favoritism. Number 2, favoritism is unreasonable. That's the second reason he says. In verses 5 to 7, he says it's illogical, it doesn't make sense. In the first place, he says, God has chosen poor people, as he goes on explaining. Has not God chosen the poor to be rich in faith and inherit the kingdom? He's not saying it's good to be poor and not to be rich. That's not what he's saying. He's not saying it's bad to be rich. He's not saying that only poor will be saved. That's not what he said there. That everybody in this room actually is rich compared to most part of the world, most of the world this morning, all of you. So he's not saying it's bad to be rich. It doesn't make any difference to God whether you're rich or poor. James is saying wealth in itself does not deserve any special treatment in the church. Your value is not based on your valuables, the kind of valuables you have. Don't confuse your net worth with your self-worth. It's illogical. That's what James was trying to point out to us. An author called James Boyce Montgomery, in a book called My Friends Are Special, well, actually, it's an article, My Friends Are Special, writes down talking about this, and he says this: in the perspective of Christ, we're all poor. We are all underprivileged. We're all nobodies who only by his grace have become somebody in responding to the gospel. We of all people ought to go to those who have no stature in this world, in the world's eyes, so that the gospel is preached and they respond to it, they might find a stature before God. Have you ever thought about this? Do you know why we kiss up to people who are affluent? Because we hope at some point they will do something for us. You don't have to know the key man if you know the one who holds the key. We forget that. He has a way of opening and closing doors regardless of your network or your contacts. I remember right in the beginning of our ministry, 2003, after my graduation, I was at a point where, you know, I was going to take a new phase of my life and with regards to youth ministry and things like that. I ended up in a conference in Singapore, and I was sitting there with a friend of mine who had already, you know, gone ahead of me to study there for Masters of Theology. And I was planning to attend the same seminar and seminary and get my master's. So while in the conference, I'm not usually a guy who goes and talks to people. I mean, in this church, I do that. But thank God, God changed me. But usually, I'm very, very introverted. So I was all by myself, and he would always try and push me and say, "Why don't you go and meet this person? Why don't you go and meet that person?" And I would say, "No. I think I'm fine with this. I'm okay to attend the conference and go back home. I'm fine with that." And one day during the lunchtime, he sat with me and he said this: "Chaitanya, you will never grow and become a successful person if you don't network with people." Now, I understand the importance of network, okay, in leadership. But this is what he told me: "You will never be successful in ministry if you don't know people, if you don't connect with the right people. You cannot grow fast." I walked away from the conference thinking I should do that. Thank God I never learned to do that. Because I've realized it doesn't matter how many key men I know, it really matters that I know the one who holds the keys. Favoritism is unreasonable. Number three, he gives the primary reason in verse 8. Favoritism is unloving. That's why we shouldn't do it. If you really keep the royal law found in the scripture, love your neighbor as yourself, you are doing right. You are now acting like a mature person. Why is it called a royal law? Because if we obeyed that one thing, we wouldn't need all the rest. All of the rest of the commands. Galatians chapter 5, verses 14. All the law is summed up in one sentence. Galatians chapter 5, verses 14. Love your neighbor as yourself. All the law. That means if I can follow this one single law, I don't need to follow any other law. Because that's the toughest one, right? If you can follow this, you don't need to follow anything else. This is the Bible saying, by the way. The Bible says that how we relate to other people shows how much we really love God. In 1 John chapter 4, verses 2. If a man says he loves God and hates his brother, he's lying. How can you love God whom you haven't seen if you don't love your brother whom you have seen? You know, a lot of us are like this poem that I read. Reader's Digest again. And it goes like this. Paul's girl is rich and haughty. My girl is poor as clay. Paul's girl is young and pretty. Mine looks like a bale of hay. Paul's girl is smart and clever. My girl is dumb but good. Would I trade my girl for Paul's? You bet I would. That's how we are. We may not say that, but that's how we are. We don't know how to love unconditionally. As we all know, all we know is that how to show favoritism. In verses 9, if you show favoritism, you sin and are convicted by the law as lawbreakers, he says. For whoever keeps the whole law and yet stumbles at just one point is guilty of breaking all of the law. Oh, that's harsh. So how many laws do you have to break in order to become a lawbreaker? You're smart. Would you tell me the answer? One. How many crimes do you have to commit in order to be called a criminal? One. How many links do you have to break in order to break a chain? One. Have you ever been in a China shop where the sign says, you break it, you bought it? It doesn't matter if it was just a slight crack or 1,000 pieces, you still have to buy it if you break it. James says that people think favoritism is such a small sin. But he says if you break God's rule, you break God's rule. So be careful, it's a serious business. He goes on explaining that in the next verse, verses 11. For who said, do not commit adultery, also said, do not murder. So if you don't commit adultery, but you do commit murder, you have become a lawbreaker. So what's he saying? He's illustrating his point, right? About being unloving. He's saying, I don't drink, I don't smoke, I don't chew, or I don't run around girls, that everybody else does. I don't do that. I don't commit adultery. What does God care if I'm just partial to somebody, to certain kinds of people? James is saying, it's all the same. You break one, you break everything. Verses 12. Speak and act as those who are being judged by the law that gives freedom, because judgment without mercy will not be shown to anyone who has been merciful. Mercy triumphs over judgment. Love treats people with mercy. Love gives people what they need, not what they deserve. It's unchristian, it's unreasonable, it's unloving to show favoritism, to be a snob. So now that we know how do we normally treat people, let's look at how do we treat people right. And that would be my thoughts that you need to know this morning. How do you have a loving church? There's an article in a newspaper that said like this. In a survey of 8,600 people from congregations in 39 different denominations, they measured their love quotient. The institute reports back that growing churches are more loving to each other and to the visitors than declining churches. Loving churches attract more people regardless of their theology, their denomination, or their location. So I realized this. That statement, that article ended up with that statement, a church that loves people is the church that grows. It's love that reaches out to people. So you don't argue people into the kingdom of God. You love them into the kingdom of God. So how do we do that? I'll give you three steps. James. Number one, accept everybody. Accept everybody. Now this is where I want to take a little extra time to talk to you today, because this is crucial. I don't know if you've ever been in a church that has spiritual snobs, you know. We got it, you don't. I'm more spiritual than you kind of people. Do you know why people have a hard time accepting others? Because they confuse acceptance with approval. That's where I want to talk on today. Spend a little extra time on that so that you will understand this. When I say accept, we usually think that we're going to excuse everything that somebody does wrong. That we don't talk about sin, we don't talk about we don't talk about indiscipline, we don't talk about a problem in the heart, a problem in the character, that we don't do anything about that. That's not what acceptance means. That's not what James is saying. Well, actually, that's not the definition of love according to the scripture. You can accept somebody without approving that person's lifestyle. He may be doing something totally contrary to the word of God, but you can accept him as a person without approving the sin that he's involved in. We don't know that difference. We think that accepting means I have to tolerate whatever that person does. No. I almost in all plugins I taught this, last 2 months, I taught about the church in Pergamum. I taught about the problem with the church in Pergamum, according to Jesus, is the church in Pergamum tolerated people who are indisciplined in the church, tolerated people who have a wrong theology and are leading others astray. And Jesus blames the entire church for tolerating people like that. He's saying, I know you guys don't sin, but if you tolerate somebody, a sinner, then you have a problem. So don't confuse acceptance with approval. Because of that, we don't want to, we either don't want to treat people right, because we don't want to have anything to do with them, and we show partiality. Here's my philosophy in acceptance. Now, this is, I don't know if it is theologically sound, but I think it is. Over the years, as your pastor, over the years, working with young people, this is what I've learned regarding accepting, the difference between acceptance and approval. And I hope it'll help you. Number one, accept all unbelievers just as they are, unconditionally. Accept all unbelievers. If a person does not know Christ, you have to accept that person unconditionally without finding fault in that person. Why? Because they don't know Christ. You know Christ. They don't know Christ. So you can't expect an unbeliever to have the same standard like you do. Am I right? Christ transformed your life. But that person has not yet met Christ. He does not have an encounter with God. So therefore, his character is going to be the same. That person's character is still going to be the same, even though they could be your friends. So you're going to accept that person unconditionally. You're not going to put bars and say, hey, here is the measurement that you need to meet in order to be my friend. You can't do that. It's very simple. So accept all unbelievers just as they are, unconditionally, and of course help them to see where they are going wrong. You have no authority over their lives, because it is the Holy Spirit who is going to change their lives. So you can't set bars on somebody who does not know Christ. Remember that. That's my philosophy. Number two, accept all believers in spite of their struggle with sin. This has been my philosophy, that I'm going to accept any believer, any person who knows Christ and is coming, being part of our lives, being part of this church, in spite of their struggle with their sin. But I'm going to teach them and help them, correct them to walk in the right path. Because now that you know Christ, I have the authority to tell you, hey, there's some problem with your life. Just correct yourself. Here is the reason why you should not be like this. Here is the reason why you should be like this. I can do that. This entire series is that, to help you to come into the right path. I think we should do that. That all believers, in spite of their struggle with sin, are given grace, offered grace, more chances in order to correct themselves. And I will help you as long as I can, as long as God gives me breath, to help you. To continue to change, to continue to grow. And I understand that there will always be people in this church, some who would run faster than others, who would grow faster than others. Some people get it immediately. Some people take time. Not that they are not smart, but that they have a struggle inside their life with sin that has been there for so long, they are not able to get rid of it. I'm not excusing that sin. I'm just saying I understand that. Because Christ understands that. And I understand that you need to be given grace, more opportunities to fight with that and come out of it. Slowly, take your time. But before Christ comes, or before you are called there, you better want to work on that. That's fine. So all believers get grace in spite of their struggle with sin. You should do that. You should keep that in your mind. Remember this, that just because you are growing faster does not mean every other believer has to grow faster like you. Just because you are the one who's reading Bible every day and have a constant, consistent relationship with God, do not expect every Christian to be the same. They cannot be. You took time to be there, right, where you are. It's the same with the other person. So give grace to that person. Don't leave that person like that, but of course you're going to talk to them, correct them, and help them, nudge them in the right direction. So accept unbelievers just as they are, unconditionally. Accept all believers in spite of their struggle with sin, but teach them and help them and correct them into the right direction. Number three, and this is very important, and this probably is a philosophy that I need to apply to myself and the people who work in the ministry, people who we call leaders. Accept all Christian leaders in spite of their imperfections. Correct them, help them, give them more opportunities. But if needed, discipline them harshly. If needed, discipline them harshly, because discipline is a sign of love. I'll tell you why we need this. We need to understand this philosophy. Let's say 5 years from now, that you as a church find that I am embezzling money from this church. Would you even give me 1 week extra chance to stand here? You won't. You'll throw me out of this church instantly. No grace. Am I right? Yes or no? Let's just be honest about it. You won't give grace to me. If I'm on stage, I'm preaching to you every Sunday, I fall at one place, you're not going to spare my life. You will give grace to everybody who's sitting beside you, but you will not give grace to me. So therefore, anyone who stands on the stage must be disciplined. There's no choice. It has to be harsh. It has to be disciplined. That does not mean we don't love the person. It just means that, hey, we actually love you more. That's why we want to help you be corrected and walk in the right path. And sometimes discipline is hurtful. Proverbs chapter 3, verses 11 and 12 says this: my son, do not refuse the correction that comes from your God. Because just as a father disciplines the one his son whom he loves and cherishes him, he disciplines you. So if God brings a discipline into my life, into discipline into a leader's life, into discipline, a discipline into somebody who serves him, it's good because God is actually showing more grace and more love to that person. And so my philosophy is very simple. Nobody's going to spare my life tomorrow. So I'm not going to spare anybody who is on stage and mess it up. I can't. It's just how we, you know, we need to move on. We have to help people to become better. So acceptance and approval are two totally different things. Remember that. Accept one another just as Christ accepted you. Yes, of course, I do. That's a start, acceptance. So at this church, we need to develop, cultivate a culture of acceptance. A church, of course, is a hospital for sinners. It's not a hotel for saints where you know, they dress up and for a dress parade. It is a place for sinners. This place is for sinners. This place, Capstone, is a place for imperfect people. Actually, if you're perfect, you don't belong here. This place is where people are growing. This church is for people who don't have it all together. So we want to have every kind people from every kind of background we can ever imagine. In fact, we do have. We've got Catholics, Charismatics, Baptists, Pentecostals, Methodists, Lutherans, Assembly of God, Hindus, Muslims, who are attending our church. For that matter, at some point, we even had atheists coming to our church. And have a very good relationship with me. Of course, they have come to Christ, by the way. Don't look at me as if, what happened to them? They did come to Christ. It doesn't matter where you have been. It doesn't matter where you are now. And if you know Jesus, that's all you need to know here, to be here. If you want to grow more and more like him, every day you're welcome here. Now, here is something that I understood. I've learned from Billy Graham. In essentials, irrespective of which denomination we come from, in essentials, we have unity. In essentials, we have unity. Christ is Lord, Bible is the word of God, Christ is coming back. In essentials, we have unity. In non-essentials, we have liberty. That some of us may believe in speaking in tongues as a sign of the anointing of God. Some of us may not understand it like that. Some of us believe in a certain type of baptism. Some of us believe that taking of communion in a different manner. Those are non-essentials. They are not going to change anything. They are not going to affect me going to the heaven, because I actually, the admission to heaven is based on one thing. Did you admit that you are a sinner? And did you accept Jesus as your personal savior? That's how you go to heaven. Nothing else. Not whether you're Assembly of God, whether you're Methodist, or whether you are CSI or IPC. It doesn't matter. If you believe in Jesus, you're going to heaven. And so, non-essentials, we have liberty. We understand. We understand you understood the scripture in a different way. That's fine. Because it's not going to affect me, it's not going to affect you. But in all things, we have charity. That we always are open to everyone, anyone who wants to walk into this place. Number two, appreciate everybody. Appreciate everybody. Number one, accept everybody. Acceptance does not mean approval. Number two, appreciate everybody. So he's taking one more step a little further, and he's saying, it's a little more, you know, he's saying, actually, let me just take you directly to Philippians. Philippians chapter 2, verses 35. Do nothing from selfish ambition or vain conceit, but in humility, consider others better than yourself. Each of you should look not only to your own interest, but also to the interests of others. So whether Paul or whether James talking to us with regards to how do we treat people, they're telling us this, that we need to learn to look what is positive in people. Because chances are we are always looking at what is negative in people. What we don't like in people. That's what attracts us most, right? So Paul is teaching us, and James is telling us, hey, always learn to look at what is good in the people. In fact, in Paul writing to the church in Philippi, chapter 1 itself, he talks about how he thanks God for them, the church in Philippi, every day in my prayers. He says, I thank my God every day because of you. The problem is, Paul has no reason to thank God for the church in Philippi. If you read Paul's life and watch Paul's journey, at some point in his journey, when he went to plant a church in Philippi, he stayed 2 years there, by the way, in and around Philippi, planting this church and helping the church to grow. He had a tough time in that church. From the day one, nobody accepted him. From the day one, he had been beaten, black and blue, thrown into the prison. At one point, he almost died in the prison itself. Yes, of course, he did see many people coming to Christ, but he did not have a good time in that city. In fact, he had to run away in the middle of the night because the entire city planned to murder him, assassinate him one day. So the church actually put him in a basket and, you know, they sent him away from that city. So if you look back at the kind of experiences he had at the church in Philippi, you wouldn't say, I'm glad for you to God, you know. I thank God for all my problems. It's almost like that. But he goes on focusing on what they were good at. He says, right from the day one, you have been with me on my journey of taking the gospel. In fact, when I moved away from you, you have always supported my journey. You've always been the one that sent offering to me so that I can take care of my travel expenses, I can take care of where I'm going, my lodging, and my ministry expenses. You have been a church that always blessed me. You've been there right from the beginning. So you need to learn to appreciate people around you. Actually, I think you need to start appreciation beginning at your home, inside your home. Start with your spouse. Stop complaining about making chai and how the biryani is, or how the pappu turned out to be. Appreciate, even if it's bad. No, I can't do that. That would be lying, right? So we have to find something good in your spouse, in your children, among your friends, and with your colleagues. I know with some people it may require a little more creativity to find something good in them, but still, you need to make an effort. You may take a little while to find good in people. But if you start at home, right from your home, you would actually develop it faster. But you need to learn this. Basically, my point is this. Learn to value people for their uniqueness. That's all. That's what appreciating means. Number three, affirm everybody. Affirm everybody. Give everybody a lift whenever you can. In 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, verses 11, Paul encourages us by saying, encourage one another and build one another up. Encourage one another, build one. So when people stumble, instead of criticizing them, sympathize with them. Be encourager, not a complainer. Not a condemner, not a critical person, but a person who says, okay, I'm going to give you another chance. I'll help you to be better, to walk in your ways. You know, instead of crab mentality, and I think we need to develop ant mentality. Discard crab mentality. I think we have a problem with crab mentality. That we don't go up, but we don't let anybody else go up. But ant has a very different mentality. That if it cannot reach up, it will have somebody else use its shoulder to reach up. And it's painful sometimes to become an ant. It's painful because you're going to bear somebody else's burden on your shoulder and it's hurt. It's hurting. But you need to help. So I guess we need to, as Christians, that we need to discard crab mentality and develop ant mentality. Let me conclude this. So basically, this is what James is saying. In four words, he's saying, treat people in the light of man's motives. Be careful with your motives when it comes to treating people, verses 2 and 4. Number two, treat people in the light of God's purposes. Understand that kingdom of God belongs to everybody. That's what he said in verses 5 and 7, 5 to 7. Understand that kingdom of God does not only belong to rich people or just poor people, it belongs to everybody. Who loves God comes into the kingdom of God. Treat people in the light of Jesus' command. That you know the royal law says, love your neighbor as yourself, verses 8 to 11. And then treat people in the light of God's mercy. Just as God shows mercy, show mercy to people. A church that accepts, appreciates, and affirms people is a church that God blesses. Absolutely nothing can stop that church from being filled with love. Nothing. Now, it doesn't happen accidentally. It starts off with us putting more effort to love one another, to help one another to grow. Together, we can make a commitment that this church will receive people unconditionally. That in this church, everybody is welcome. Everybody is welcome. We don't expect people to behave in a certain way. We don't set marks on how people would behave inside the church and outside of the church. We don't set marks on how they need to dress up or how they should not dress up. Now, I'm sure when people know God, they know how to dress themselves up. So you can't, put a gaze on how a person should dress up. We don't expect people to act like believers until they are believers. That nothing can stop a loving church. Let's become that. Let's move towards that. Listen, you may be a visitor today, first time, as our guest. Thank you for joining us today. It really doesn't matter who you are, what you wear, where you have come from, what work do you do. It really doesn't matter how messed up your relationships were in the past. Once married, never married, married 10 times, messed up again. It doesn't matter if you speak in tongues or pray quietly. It doesn't matter whether you disagree with me in the interpretation of the scriptures on the second coming, specifically. You're welcome here. This is your church. This is your family. You don't have to feel, I'm a different person. No, you don't have to. We're all different. We're all imperfect. I am imperfect. Last week I told that I make decisions. Some decisions are very bad. And I mess up most of my decisions. But yet, it's because of the grace of God I'm still here, I'm still serving you as your leader. So it's okay who you are, however you have come. Thank you for coming today. You're welcome to come back again. You're welcome to become part of this church, our family. Christ already broke down any barriers, if there were, at the cross. So we don't put any more barriers. Galatians chapter 3, verses 26 to 37. Let me read there when we are closing. For now, we are all children of God through faith in Christ. We are no longer Jew or Greek or slave or a free man or even man or woman. We are all same. There is no distinction in the body of Christ. We are all Christians. We are one in Christ Jesus. Let's treat people like that. Let's close our eyes. If you have been a person who has developed. You know, a heart, a personality that discriminates one from another. Today you have this privilege, opportunity to ask God to correct you. And God is good. He wants to forgive you and help you. Thank God that God doesn't show partiality on us. Learn to be a person who doesn't show favorites. How you treat people matters to God. So treat people well. Ask God to give you wisdom. Ask God to give you a heart to treat people well and wise. Just a small, short prayer, and I'd like you to take this moment to pray for yourself and offer yourself, your life, your family to Him.